एफएससी बायोलॉजी क्विक चैप्टर समरीज। एफएससी बायोलॉजी क्विक चैप्टर समरीज चैप्टर 15 होमियोस्टेसिस फॉर द प्रिपरेशन ऑफ पीपीएससी लेक्चरर एंड सब्जेक्ट स्पेशलिस्ट जूलॉजी एंड बायोलॉजी। इन दिस लेक्चर वी शैल डिस्कस होमियोस्टेसिस सम जनरल कॉन्सेप्ट्स ऑस्मोरेगुलेशन इन बोथ प्लांट्स एंड एनिमल्स एक्सक्रीशन सम जनरल फैक्ट्स एक्सक्रीशन इन इनवर्टिब्रेट्स इन ह्यूमन नेफ्रोन स्ट्रक्चर एंड फंक्शन किडनी प्रॉब्लम्स एंड क्योर एंड फाइनली द मोस्ट इंपॉर्टेंट थर्मोरेगुलेशन। Allah says in Quran that there is nothing for man except what he strives for. So if you want success in a competition, then struggle for it consistently. You shall be bestowed with success when your struggle became more than others. So let's strive together. Homeostasis. Organisms resist and manage internal fluctuations in a narrow range in cells, tissues, organs and organism levels against external fluctuations or changes. That is called homeostasis. Now, the important keyword in this sentence is the narrow range. Most susceptible components which are at risk of fluctuations are water, solute and temperature. So these three components, water, solute and temperature, can easily be altered when external conditions change. Homeostasis compel the adaptations and hence contribute in evolution. So homeostasis actually indirectly help evolution to occur. Homeostasis does not mean to keep fixed internal environment but in a narrow range of the conditions. Living control systems work exactly on mechanism of physical control system, like the thermostat for temperature is working in a refrigerator, as well as the thermostat is working in the iron clothing, etc. Thermoregulation work on the principle of negative feedback, that the products itself regulate the process and stop the beginning or the start of the process. Quantity of water in cells depends upon amount of salt. If a cell has a high amount of salt, then the water will become inside the cell. Similarly, if it has low concentration of salt inside, then water will be discharged outside. Hypotonic mean low solute, hypertonic mean high solute, isotonic mean same. So the hypotonic, isotonic and hypertonic are actually opposite to the concentration of water. Hypotonic mean low solute but high water. Hypertonic mean high solute but low water, and isotonic almost same water concentration outside and inside. Hydrophytes are freshwater plants. Now, how they are adapted? They have large leaves with extensive stromata on the upper side. For example, in a water lily, we can observe that the leaves are large and they are actually lie on the surface of water. So, it is difficult to evaporate water from the underside because it is dipped in the water. So, the stromata are present only on upper side for easy transpiration or loss of water because they have excess amount of water. Now, mesophytes are intermediates, which are moderate plants, and they have the control system to open and close stomata when it is like during a hot and dry day, stomata closed, as well as during night, stomata become closed to avoid excess water loss, or when water is in plenty, then they can transpire more. For example, rose, mango and basilica are mesophytes. Xerophytes are actually dry plants or desert plants, and they have very important adaptations to conserve water mainly. For example, they have small and reduced leaves to reduce water loss through transpiration. They have thick waxy cuticle on the surface of the plant, which reduce further evaporation of water from general body surface as well as stromata on lower side in a depression further to decrease the loss of water or transpiration. Similarly, they also shed their leaves to restrict transpiration when there is extreme drought conditions. Also, they can store water in their stem, and that can be used when extreme or stressful conditions reached. Now, osmoconformers, being isotonic, do not require to adjust osmotic state because the concentration of solute inside the organism and outside the organism are almost the same. That's why water neither moves inside nor move outside. But osmoregulators regulate fluid concentrations by discharging water when in hypotonic environment and secreting salt when in hypertonic environment. Please remember. Most marine invertebrates are osmoconformers, that is they do not need to change their body temperatures, and they are isotonic with the environment. among vertebrates, hagfishes are osmoconformers being isotonic. No, that is the distinction for hagfishes, and please remember this fact. Hagfishes are osmoconformers among vertebrates. Most cartilaginous fishes maintain lower salt concentration inside, and they excrete salt using kidneys through gills as well as by rectal glands. Rectal glands are actually salt excreting organs in these fishes. Some fishes retain urea to be hypertonic using TMA. Now we know that if urea concentration increases in the body, that is dangerous. So that dangerous aspect or impact of the urea is neutralized by TMAO. So they have TMAO to counter the dangerous aspect of urea. That's why they can retain high concentration of urea inside to be hypertonic and to disguise in the water concentration. Bonefishes are descendants of freshwater ancestors. Now bonefishes descend from freshwater, but later they acquired marine habitat or marine environment. Bonefishes drink large amount of seawater and excrete concentrated urine. That's the balance. Contractile vacuoles push extra water out in freshwater amoeba and paramecium. Now if you want the live video of contractile vacuole, then you can search on my channel contractile vacuole and you shall find a live video of contractile vacuole working. Freshwater fishes excrete dilute urine, take salts from food, skin and gills. So from where freshwater fishes take salts? They take salts from food, skin and gills, please remember. Now kangaroo rats survive without drinking water, and it is said that throughout life they do not drink water because carbohydrates in them produce water for the metabolism and they do not need to drink direct water from outside. And hydrobiosis is the tolerance of dehydration. How much dehydration can be tolerated by an terrestrial or animal is called anhydrobiosis. Excretion. Elimination of wasteful metabolites mainly of nitrogenous nature. So excretion of actually nitrogenous waste products is termed as excretion, not other products. Plants excrete waste by storage and then shedding off leaves and stems which have waste products, and they are shed off. Leaves of plants which fall in autumn are said to be excretophores because they have large amount of waste products stored, and when they are shed, actually those waste products are removed from the plant. Yellowing of leaves in autumn is not due to loss of chlorophyll, please remember, but that is due to accumulation of waste products, especially some metals or metallic waste products. It is observed in a study that those leaves which are more yellow have high concentration of metal ions. Some trees deposit strange chemicals in old dead xylem tubes. Now this result into very black ebony wood in the center. So some trees have black wood, that is due to deposition of some chemicals in the dead xylem tubes which are now inactive. Conifers excrete waste as chemical weapon in soil against competing plants. Water is an excretory product in hypoosmotic environment, while salts are excretory product in hypertonic environment. Please remember the distinction. Deamination is the catabolic release of amino group from amino acid. So that is the definition of deamination. To be excreted, this amino group is converted into ammonia, urea or uric acid. Lower or reduced quantities of nitrogen are excreted as creatinine, creatine, TMAO, amino acids, purines and pyrimidines. Now please link these products with the lower or reduced quantities of nitrogen. Purine and pyrimidine nitrogenous bases. Metabolism produces significant amount of nitrogenous waste like hypoxanthine, xanthine, uric acid, allantoin, urea and ammonia. Allantoin actually is an intermediate waste product which convert into others. Many fishes excrete ammonia. Mammals, amphibians, sharks and some bony fishes excrete urea. Birds, insect, many reptiles and land snail. Please remember that is a distinction. Land snail also excrete uric acid. Excretion of ammonia is possible in hypotonic environment only. So if water is present in excess amount outside, then the excreted product is ammonia. About 500 ml of water is needed to excrete 1 gram of ammonia nitrogen. So that nitrogen actually in the form of ammonia. Now urea require 50 ml of water to excrete 1 gram of nitrogen. 1 ml water only is required to excrete nitrogen through uric acid. So that is the adaptation based on the plenty or amount of water present. In terrestrial animals, nitrogen is converted metabolically to urea through urea cycle or ornithine cycle. Ammonotelic animals excrete ammonia, ureotelic urea, uricotelic excrete uric acid. Urea cycle. That's a simple summary of the cycle. Urea cycle or ornithine cycle occurs in ureotelic animals. The cycle produces urea from ammonia. Urea cycle takes place in liver and kidneys. Please remember their location. In first step, ammonia combined with carbon dioxide to form citrulline in mitochondria. Citrulline comes in cytosol to combine with aspartate to form argininosuccinate. Argininosuccinate then absorb another ammonia molecule and change into arginine by the enzyme arginase. Arginine then combine with water to generate ornithine and one molecule of urea. Ornithine then recycle into citrulline again by combining with ammonia and carbon dioxide. So that is a simple summary of urea cycle, which is actually discussed in the textbook, but the details are more. Now, excretion in planaria, earthworm and cockroach. And please remember, hydra excretion is very simple, that water is present in excess surrounding the body, and ammonia is directly excreted into the water from inside or outside. Planaria. Protonephridium in planaria is a network of closed tubules with nephridiopores. Nephridiopores are actually the pores. Each branch is capped. Each branch of nephridium is capped by a flame cell which has tuft of flagella, and that flagella when beat, they're flickering, just look like a flame of candle. That's why they are called as flame cell. Actually, that is the flagella beating. Freshwater flatworms excrete dilute urine, while parasites flatworms dispose nitrogenous waste directly into the host. Each segment of earthworm has pair of metanephridia with internal nephrostome opening. Coelomic fluid while moves, epithelium of the tubule reabsorbs salt and sent to blood surrounding. Malpighian tubules in terrestrial arthropods like cockroach collect hemolymph in sinuses. Malpighian tubules are only excretory structures associated with digestive tract. Please remember, that is the only feature present in these insects and not present in all other animal kingdom. Epithelial lining of tubules absorb salt and nitrogenous waste and pass to rectum. That MCQ is very important and that already had been asked. Rectum reabsorbs most of salt and water, and solid uric acid crystals are excreted. Insects are only animals among whole kingdom which excrete waste like nitrogenous waste with feces. Excretion in humans. Hagfishes have kidneys with segmentally arranged tubules. That point was actually a previous slide, but due to space I have written here. Hagfishes has kidneys with segmentally arranged tubules. Please remember. Generation of waste is primarily done at metabolic level. So when metabolism occurs, waste are produced. Urea is produced from metabolism of amino acids. Creatinine is produced from muscle creatin. Uric acid is produced from nucleic acids, and bilirubin is produced by breakdown of hemoglobin as well as breakdown of hormones. So these are the waste products produced from their respective precursor substances. Please remember, liver, central station of metabolism as well as metabolic clearing house or check post. pivotal to homeostasis and interact with most organs of the body. So if you are asked in an MCQ that which organ of the body is pivotal to homeostasis, you must attempt liver, not other like kidneys. Help kidneys by detoxifying chemical poisons and producing ammonia, urea, uric acid from nitrogen of amino acids. That is the function of liver as well. Now, removal of water and salts by sweat glands is for thermoregulation. Please remember, that is not actually excretion. Similarly, while sebum from sebaceous glands help to protect against microorganisms, and that excretion of sebum is also not excretion or excretory product. Their functions or their purposes are different, not as waste. Urea is principal nitrogenous waste product found by liver from waste nitrogen using urea cycle, and two ammonia and one carbon dioxide molecules actually utilized in the cycle and produce one molecule of urea in each cycle. Second ammonia combined with citrulline to form arginine, which split by arginase enzyme to urea. Now, liver synthesize or form plasma proteins like prothrombin, fibrinogen, which are blood clotting, while albumin protein maintain osmotic balance of blood. So the function of albumin here is important, and it is a distinction. Liver produces bile, which emulsify fats in small intestine, like it converts into small droplets which are easily digestible. Lipids, cholesterol and lipoproteins are formed in the liver, which regulate, store energy and maintain membranes of the cells. It stores iron for hemoglobin liver. Liver converts glucose into glycogen as energy reserve. Now, these three definitions are very important for you, although these are not present in the text, but I have added for you. Glycogenesis is the process of glycogen synthesis from glucose, while glycogenolysis is the breakdown of glycogen into glucose again, and gluconeogenesis is generation of glucose from non-carbohydrates like pyruvate. So these three definitions are quite important, and please remember them. Hemoglobin from old red blood cells is recycled in liver to get mainly iron and some other components of the RBCs. Urinary system. Kidneys receive 20% of blood with each cardiac beat. Urine is collected in central cavity of kidney called pelvis. That is very important. Pelvis is the place where urine is collected. Both ureters drain into bladder through ureteral orifice. Sphincter muscles at junction of bladder and urethra control the urine in bladder or flow of outside. There are two types of nephrons based on the regions of location inside the kidney. Cortical nephrons are arranged along the cortex, only in the cortex, while gestamedullary are arranged at the border of cortex and medulla with tubules deep into medulla. So on the basis of these regions, there are two types of nephrons, cortical and gestamedullary. Gestamedullary are instrumental in producing concentrated urine. Please remember, afferent arterioles supply blood to glomerulus, while efferent arterioles eject or take away blood from glomerulus. But this ejected blood vessel again divides into peritubular capillaries, which surround the proximal distal or loop of Henle. Next. Now, first descending tubule from Bowman capsule in a nephron is proximal tubule, then loop of Henle, and then ascending tubule, the distal tubule, which empties into collecting duct. Collecting duct then empties into pelvis. Now, peritubular capillaries intermingle with proximal and distal tubules for reabsorption. In gestamedullary nephrons, Peritubular capillaries further extend down to form loop of vessels called vasa recta. So please remember, vasa recta or vasa recta are only present in gestamedullary nephrons, not in cortical nephrons. Glomerular filtrate have glucose, amino acids and salts, which are quite useful for the body, and they must be reabsorbed. So this reabsorption of useful products occur in proximal tubule. That is very, very important point for you to understand. Reabsorption of the most products occur in the proximal tubule or the first descending tubule. After passing from proximal tubule, the filtrate contains mostly nitrogenous waste only, and all the useful products are reabsorbed. Epithelium of tubules secrete hydrogen ions to balance the pH of filtrate. That is another very important aspect for you to remember, please. In hypoosmotic body fluid or excess water in body, antidiuretic hormone or ADH is inhibited or stopped to be released. If water is deficient in body, then ADH release increase reabsorption of almost 99.5% of water and the urine is almost none. Interstitial fluid of kidney is gradually concentrated from cortical toward medullary part. That's why gestamedullary nephrons have more concentrated urine. So inner medulla is highly concentrated with urea by counter current multiplier. Ascending loop of Henle actively transport sodium ion. Actively transport means it uses energy, sodium ions, into kidney interstitium to sustain its high concentration, that is sodium ions. Ascending loop of Henle is thick and uptake of sodium ions is promoted by aldosterone, and aldosterone hormone is secreted by adrenal cortex present on kidneys. Reabsorption also takes place in collecting tubules. Please remember, reabsorption not only occur in the proximal or distal, but it is continuous up to collecting tubules. ADH from posterior pituitary actively transport means it uses energy or ATP from filtrate in distal and collecting tubules back to kidneys. Important thing. Now, kidney problems and cures. Kidney stones are formed in hypercalcemia or hyperzeluria. Hypercalcemia mean high calcium concentration, and hyperzeluria mean high oxalate salts. Stones are basically calcium oxalates most of the time. Oxalates are present in green vegetables and tomatoes. So we can say that the green vegetables and tomatoes can cause the kidney stones. Calcium oxalate stones are 70% of all types of kidney stones, while calcium phosphate stones are 15%, and uric acid stones are also stones which constitute about 10% of all the stones of the kidneys. In lithotripsy, high concentration of X-rays or ultrasound are directed to break the stones into sand or small pieces which can pass out through urine easily. Most common is extracorporeal shock wave lithotripsy, that's a technique. In renal failure, when the kidneys become totally failed, glomerular part of nephron is destroyed, which result in rise of urea and nitrogenous waste in blood, which then cause blood pressure and anemia, and these are thought as the symptoms that the kidneys have been failed. Dialysis. Hemodialysis mean cleaning the blood. Please remember, hemodialysis mean cleaning the blood, and that MCQ has already been asked in the past paper. Blood is circulated through artificial kidney, the dialyzer. So artificial kidney is also called dialyzer, which has two spaces separated by thin membrane. On one side, blood passes, while on other side, dialysis fluid circulates. Now, peritoneal dialysis occurs through peritoneum, a thin epithelium in peritoneal cavity of the abdomen. Dialysis fluid is filled in the cavity through catheter, and filtration occurs inside. Peritoneal dialysis is repeated several times a day. That is a distinction from the hemodialysis. Uremia. is end stage renal disease in which dialysis cannot be done and the only option left is the kidney transplant. Thermoregulation. Plants use evaporative cooling to manage high temperatures. As alternative during very hot and dry season in temperate regions when stomata are closed, heat shock proteins embrace enzymes or cover enzymes or take enzymes and proteins to avoid their denaturation. So heat shock proteins are actually quite helpful in dry and hot seasons when other techniques fail. Fluidity of cell membrane alters or changes in low temperature due to lipids lock or freeze in the form of crystals. This is dealt or treated by increasing unsaturated fatty acids in membranes. But this adaptation requires time. That's why rapid chilling of plants is more stressful. For freezing temperatures, plants change the solute concentration of protoplasm to become supercooled to avoid crystal formation in the protoplasm like oak plants, roses and maples, which are the residents of freezing areas. Infrared radiation of sunlight or simply sunlight transfer heat into animals, while radiation and evaporation from the body transfer heat out. All invertebrates, fish, amphibians and reptiles are pycnotherms, which change internal body temperature as with surrounding air or water changes. Homeotherms maintain internal temperature like birds and mammals. Now these two definitions, pycnotherms and homeotherms, are not quite general and they do not cover all the types or categories of animals. That's why some new definitions have been introduced. Like endotherms are those organisms which produce heat as byproduct during metabolism, hence can maintain internal temperature like flying insects, some fishes, birds and mammals are endotherms. While ectotherms also produce metabolic heat but at a low level, which is quickly exchanged and sent to outside, and there is no effect of that heat on maintaining the temperature. Also they absorb heat from surrounding, that's why they are called ectotherms. Now another terminology, heterotherms, which are capable of varying endothermic heat but do not regulate heat, are heterotherms. For example, bats and hummingbird. Please remember, bats and hummingbird are example of heterotherms. Subdermal fatty layer for insulation and pelage. Pelage mean fur, hair or wool. Sweat glands. Lungs modified for panting or structural adaptations to regulate temperature. So which of the following are structures which are adapted for thermoregulation? Please remember all these names. Fatty dermal layer, pelage, sweat glands, lungs modified for panting, etc. are structural adaptations. That list is important for you to remember. Panting is short, quick breathing or out of breathing like dogs and leopards do when they run or when there is summer. In mammals, skin has been adopted as organ of thermoregulation. Now, range of body temperature in mammals is from 36 to 38 degrees centigrade, that is in all mammals almost. Now, in shivering thermogenesis, mammals increase heat production by muscle contraction, while if hormones like thyroid hormones increase heat production, it is non-shivering thermogenesis. So in shivering, actually the muscle contractions is involved and body vibrate to generate heat. But in non-shivering, hormones directly increase heat production. Brown fat is a specialized fat for rapid heat production in some mammals, like it is linked with the beer. Vasodilation and constriction contribute to regional differences in temperature. Regional differences mean during winter our hands and arms become cold while our neck and internal body parts remain hot. So that is the regional difference, and that is under the control of vasodilation and vasoconstriction of the vessels or capillaries surrounding the skin. During old humans, cold humans keep sensitive organs warm, like trunk where glands are present. Raising furs or raising hairs trap thicker layer of still air, which provide more insulation to some mammals. Humans use insulating layer of fats just beneath the skin to avoid heat loss. Whales and seals has thick layer of insulating fat under skin called as blubber. Please remember, whales and seals has blubber, the thick layer of fat underneath the skin to avoid heat loss. In humans, hypothalamus serve as thermostat. Hypothalamus control actually the temperature for regulating temperature through vasodilation and vasoconstriction of exposed areas like skin. Normal body temperature of human is between 36.1 degree centigrade and 37.8 degree centigrade. Skin blood vessels dilate and warm blood supply increases during warm outside, while skin blood vessels constrict and less blood is supplied, hence retaining the heat during cold or winter. Bats use saliva and urine for evaporative cooling. The evaporative cooling in the respiratory tract by short and quick breath is panting. In bacterial or viral infections, leukocytes increase in number. These pathogens and blood cells produce pyrogens. Now please remember the name pyrogen. Pyrogens actually displace the set point of hypothalamus above normal, causing fever. Now temperature fever is also called pyrexia because of pyrogens. High temperature stimulate protective mechanisms against pathogens or kill them directly due to high temperature. So that's it for this chapter. Inshallah, the next chapter will be chapter 16, support and movement. To watch other chapters, check the playlist on the channel or go in the description for the links. Thank you so much. Stay happy, stay healthy, stay successful, and stay prepared. Allah Hafiz.